One is from the Gospel of Rayford. And the better one is from the Gospel of Matthew. The first parable. And I have to watch my time because this story could get a little longer. When I was rector of St. Paul's Church in Waco, I was there for only 18 years, and I had a wonderful member of the congregation who was an engineer. No offense to engineers, but he was really smart, and he knew he was, and he wanted you to know he was, and he was very prosperous, and he did well in all that he did. And he was a consultant to us at times on buildings and structure and things like that. But my dear friend Glenn could not understand why we spent so much money and gave so much money to our parish day school. Why would you spend money on that when we could do so much for the church and fix it up and improve its looks? And I kept saying to my friend Glenn, well, Glenn, you know, it's part of the mission of the church. The church decided to have a day school so they could reach out to children and their families. He still didn't believe that. Then he would come to me again and say, you know, we give too much money to the school, and I think we should cut back on that. So, well, you know, we really touch these children. I think that we did chapel 3 times a week, and it's really wonderful. And I think they're understanding about God's love. And not a lot, but a number of those children don't have a church home. And this is their church. Well, I still think it's too much money. We went from, when I went there, giving about $5,000 a year to the school to underwrite its budget, until the time I retired, to we were giving $65,000. And so finally, I said, Glenn, the last time he complained, literally the last time he complained, Glenn, we have people in the school who've actually been in a confirmation class. And we get, I did 3 confirmation classes a year, and in every confirmation class, we would have 1 or 2 families from the school, because they were drugged there by their children. And he said, oh, I don't care. I said, that's still not, you know, I said, and oh, and, but I said, and they, you know, they're active. They come to church and Sunday school and adult class, and they pledge. And I said, in fact, one of the new families, and this was back in the early 80s. I'm trying to think of what the economy was in the early 80s. I said, well, there's one family, they join their pledge, and they give $15,000 a year in a pledge. Silence. No more complaints. I knew what people gave as the rector. He gave 5. He could have done 10 times that much. That's a parable about several things. One of them is, you've got to get off your, you have to move from not doing very much in your giving to doing more of what God's calling you to do. You've got to do more in your giving of yourself and your talents as this church grows than maybe some of you all are doing. Now granted, I can say that because I'm going to leave in about an hour. But that's a parable for me about commitment and about, in many ways, sowing the seed. Now we'll turn to a much more profound parable from Matthew, which, as you all know, the early church felt like this was such an important parable of Jesus, probably one of the best known, that it's in all 3 of the synoptics, in Matthew and Mark and Luke. So it was an important parable to the early church. I want to look at this rich parable again and remember that hearing Jesus' parable for the first time, or maybe the 10th, or maybe the 100th, there's always something in it that we learn again. Please don't tell the bishop I said this, but I happen to be one of those persons who possibly believe that Jesus may have been married and had a family. I know that it may be a stretch biblically, but a parable like this one indicates to me that Jesus captures some of the frustration of parenting. I cannot count the amount of good seed that I have tried to cast on what appears to be rocky soil of an adolescent spirit. For that matter, during my 32 years of parish ministry, I remember the good seeds that I routinely broadcast in the worship community each Sunday, yet seem more often than not to fall among the weeds and be trampled underfoot. And as a bishop, I find myself frantically trying to hoe, to weed, to water, to provide sunlight to clergy and lay leaders. I am anxious simply because I cannot control the whole process. Then there are other times that I can let those seeds go in with a light heart from my part, fully confident that much is happening out of sight and out of my control that will eventually produce good fruit. For me, one of the best ways to understand this parable is to simply reread it and reread what Jesus said about that parable. You know, the great Martin Luther believed, I think, that the fate of the Word of God depends on the heart into which it is sown. And that is so true. An additional approach for me comes out of the context of the parable and its immediate audience. When Jesus spoke that, remember, he had been banished from the synagogue. The religious leaders were against him. They would ultimately use things like this, he said, and others to get rid of him. There were setbacks, and there were failures in his ministry that we read a little about, and we don't read about all of those. These disciples would become discouraged, and some would fall away, we know. I would not be, as Jesus said, I will not be with you much longer. And then he goes on to say, I will be with you always. He was giving them hope in their work and their ministry of sowing the seed. Today we can point to persons or communities that have grown, have taken root gradually and grown faithfully in the rocky soil. I think of a stark example of Mother Teresa. Taking her ministry to the very poor and neglected of India. That's pretty rocky soil. I think of those women and men who minister inside prisons, who deal with people who are rejected by society, or those women and men who work with people who have addiction and who are prostitutes or homeless. I know each of them see Christ in the outcast and the downtrodden and the battered. They are trying to sow the seed in difficult soil. This is plain and simple a parable for the sowers in Jesus' day, a parable to his immediate disciples. This was their instruction and their warning. Today, it is a parable for his disciples, those of us gathered here this morning in this newly dedicated church. Who's responsible? Responsibility it is to spread the word, to sow the seed. It is not up to us to be sure we do the work and make sure that everything happens right. That's in God's hands. Our job is to sow the seed. In that parable I told you, it was the job of the church to sow the seed in that school so children could understand that God loves them. We have to prepare the ground as much as we can, but then trust in the generous and merciful God that we worship. Sometimes we throw caution to the wind and watch with delight as God's word is accomplished in what we never dreamed of. And this may be stretching a little bit, but this is an example of that. Throwing caution to the wind. Why leave a place that looks like a church into a place that we had to change it into looking like a church? And it's, you know, we still have some work in the traditional sense of, but this is not what it's about. So the disciples needed an explanation. The explanation they got has provided generations of Sunday school lessons with the emphasis on how we receive the Word of God so generously scattered abroad. Remember that the sower just threw the seeds in all places. This is an immensely puzzling story in many ways. It's hard to see what those who hear it, the Word of God, are supposed to do about it. I don't think there's any blame intended on them, but the real key is the sower. It is the sower who starts the story. And the explanation is given to those who are going to be the sower, the disciples that Jesus spoke to. God may be the primary sower, but the disciples have attempted the commission, or they've accepted through their following of Jesus, and for us as baptized members, we've accepted that commission to spreading the word. So it is the duty to make sure that the soil is prepared, that birds are scattered away, that thorns are uprooted, and the seed does not fall where there is not enough soil to let it grow. The disciples are being given the key, not to make them feel superior, because they, remember, they did feel superior at different times, but to assure them of their status in the inner circle. They wanted that, but that's not what this is about. But it was about being responsible for those who have no other means of hearing God's word. It is the disciple of Jesus that speaks, and in it he is saying, and I really believe that we can kind of paraphrase what Jesus is saying. Every farmer knows that some of his seed will be lost. I have replanted twice my collard greens and my mustard greens. I don't know what happened to them, but they're now starting to sprout. But I know that not every one of those seeds will come up. It cannot all go. But that does not discourage the disciple to make his or her ability to keep sowing in spite of what may happen to those seeds. Because the harvest is sure. That's what Jesus promised. And it is though Jesus is saying to his disciples, I know we'll have setbacks in our discouragements. I know we have our enemies and our opponents, but but never despair. In the end, the harvest is sure. So this parable can be both a warning to us as to how we hear and receive the Word of God, and an encouragement along the way. One of the things that I want to close with is to remind each of us, it's not up to us to save the world. That's God's business, as it was with those first disciples. There were limitations, and they knew that. Christ even ultimately told them that they would have setbacks. We need not give up. We need to persevere and to keep trying and working because of who knows where we are in our pilgrimage and who knows where those other people are in their pilgrimage. And we are the ones, as His disciples, who will be broadcasting those seeds. So each of you all gathered here today has a commitment that you made or was made in your behalf as a disciple to spread God's Word, to try to plant that seed of God's Word of love and forgiveness and acceptance to all those you come in contact with. Some will fall on the rocky ground, and some will fall on the thorns, and some will fall on the path, and some will fall on good ground. But it's your job and my job to sow the seed.